Good afternoon, everyone. There's no one waiting outside, so although we're half a minute early, we're going to begin. And thank you all for coming. Now, I should first confirm that we're recording this presentation, so I hope you have no problems with that. And the second thing is that we're an informal, we do things informally in a lot of ways as a CCS. And we're very pleased that today with us is Len Hewitt. And Len was the project leader of the Pegasus project for many years. And we're delighted to see you here, Len. And this is by way of an unbirthday present, because Alan Thompson, who is an ex-Valenti man himself, saw this bottle, and it's called Pegasus, and thought of you, Len. And he tried it, because it would be awful to give a bottle of wine that was not a drink, but not this bottle, another one. And so we'd just like to present it to you, Len. So thank you very much. Now we're delighted that our speaker here today is a distinguished software engineer, Martyn Thomas. Martin's worked in the software industry and with university and government research teams for getting on for not quite half a century. He founded Praxis, and in the 1990s he was a partner with Deloitte Consulting with worldwide responsibilities for software engineering, and then returning for working for himself as a consultant and as an expert witness in major litigation. He's been a director of the Serious Organised Crime Agency and he's currently a director of the Health and Safety Executive. And he's going to speak to us on crises and lessons from the history of software. And he won't go on for weeks, but hang over to you.
I'm glad to hear I won't be going on for weeks. I'm supposed to be cooking supper tonight. It's a pleasure, a privilege, and somewhat daunting talking in front of a group of people, many of whom have actually been more intimately involved with the history of software than I have. All of us of a certain age have lived through an astonishing revolution, a series of astonishing revolutions. And most technologies, if you get a factor of 10 improvement in price performance, it just revolutionizes the industry that technology is supporting, and we get that every 5 years. So we've seen a lot of revolutions, and we've made a lot of mistakes, and we've learned a lot, and at least some of us have learned a lot, and many of the things that have been learnt by some have not been learnt more widely, and that's basically what I want to talk about, and I want to ask your help for what we can do about it when we get on to questions. You know this stuff. Modern computing started in 1948, and along with the hardware, we needed software. And it started fairly straightforwardly, as you would expect. And it's chastening, I think, to remember how quickly we started using computing seriously. And the Leo software was an extraordinary achievement so soon after stored program computing had actually been invented. Quite remarkable achievement, I think. And in many ways, probably a better product than a lot of the products that we've got now. It seemed to have been very reliable. The software didn't crash as often as the hardware did in the early days, and it really was an extraordinary achievement. And then we moved into high-level languages. Again, a history that I'm sure you know. I particularly like the quote from Tony Hoare, because that's an early lesson. Algol introduced recursion and important features for structured programming, as we know. And Tony Hall said it was a great advance on its predecessors and most of its successors. And I personally believe that very strongly. I think that most modern computer languages have got a lot to learn from ALGOL 60, and most current programmers would program a lot better if they tried to write their algorithms first in ALGOL 60 before trying to implement them in something else. But quite quickly, computer scientists started making serious progress in how software could be developed in a way that made it possible to reason about what it was doing. And this was, the need for that was observation that actually goes back at least to Alan Turing. He was writing before there was software about the fact that software would need, that algorithms implemented in a computing engine would need to be able to be reasoned about if you were ever to be able to show that you could get a reasonably high confidence that they were doing what you wanted them to do. And quite early in the development of software, we were getting the sort of techniques available that would enable software to be reasoned about, so that it was possible then to start writing programs and to have a higher confidence that you were writing a program that did what you wanted it to do than, as we shall see, most of us can have about most software we use today. So by the time we got into the 1960s, we'd got the basis for writing big software. We were writing some fairly big software. IBM's OS 360 was a pretty large piece of software, cost a lot of money, was late, of course, as you would expect, because it was a first of its kind. But already, because of the rapid expansion in use of computers, we had a software crisis. It was actually described in those terms, that there was a software crisis in the 1960s already. Defense projects were overrunning significantly. That was a big problem for the NATO countries. And the science group of NATO decided that they needed to do something about it. And of course, they called together a bunch of the experts from around the world to look at what could be done, and the software engineering conferences started. And those software engineering conferences are well worth reading still. 1968, 1969, the books, hard to find, I've got copies, but the complete text is online. Brian Randall has put the texts online, and they can be found. That's what the books look like, and that's where the where Brian has put the texts. They really are quite enlightening, because they not only paint a picture of what software development was like in the 1960s, but they also show what people were thinking were the solutions. And one of the insights that came out of that was the need for analyzable programming languages. It's a quote from Lowry, who was an IBMer, saying that any significant advance in the programming art is sure to involve very extensive automated analyses of programs. Doing thorough analyses of programs is a big job. It requires a programming language which is susceptible to analysis. And he predicted that all other programming languages would be recognized as unfit for purpose and head back to the junk shop or be overhauled to make them fit for purpose. That hasn't happened. That prediction was misguided. It was a statement of what ought to happen rather than a statement of what was actually likely to happen. And one of the things that I think we still need to do, one of the lessons that we still need to learn as an industry, is that we should not be writing programs in languages that you cannot analyze automatically. in depth to see what it is they say they're doing. Because if you can't analyse them automatically, you sure as hell can't analyse them with a human brain either. Because what it means is you don't have a properly specified language. There are ambiguities there which defeat automated analysis and which will undoubtedly confuse the human, even more than they defeat the automated analysis, almost certainly. And the second big insight was on testing. And Tony Hoare and Dijkstra's comments are extremely pertinent to the work that we do now. And remember, this was, you know, 40, getting on 50 years ago. And yet, these truths are essentially ignored, not just by most industrial programmers, but by most international standards, even in the area of safety critical computing. And that's shocking, because it opens up a really deep question about what we think we're about as a profession. If these truths, which are demonstrably true and very widely accepted, certainly amongst computer scientists, if not by programmers, haven't even managed to get into the international standards for safety critical computing. And we're going to face some interesting challenges when, for example, driverless cars start to hit the streets in big numbers. And we start wondering how we're going to develop sufficient confidence in the behaviour of a deep learning system, a neural net, for example, other than by relying on testing. And then we'll perhaps, if we have the insight, start worrying about how much of that testing experience even we can rely on if, as Tesla do today, for example, the software is being updated over the internet in real time and sometimes while you're driving. I'm told sometimes while you're driving. Maybe Tesla don't actually do that, but let's hope not. Let's assume it always happens when the car is stationary and there's nobody in it. But even so, it does, at least in theory, invalidate the testing experience you've got beforehand, because you're dealing with a new object now. So by the time we got into the 1970s, we'd got scientific foundations for software engineering. IBM were preparing a mathematically formal definition of PL1. That's where VDM, the Vienna Development Method, came from. Cliff Jones was working on that. Cliff Jones is essentially still working on that. And it has been a really powerful notation for specifying and reasoning about software. But that came from the late 60s and was in growing use by the time we got into the 1970s. And Dijkstra had introduced structured programming, most famously by the very short note that he wrote on the damage to your ability to being able to reason about a program by having go-tos in it. And so the famous article, short article, which was in fact published as a letter, "Go-to Considered Harmful," was written for that purpose. It was to illustrate the observation that he'd made that the disturbances to control flow that came out of introducing go-tos made it very hard to analyze programs and to reason about their state at any textual point, because you couldn't readily see how you got to a particular point in the program. And that led him to look at the theoretical work of Jacopini and Bohm, who'd shown that any program could be written using just two constructions, a loop and an if statement, essentially, with of course sequence as just normal control flow as a sort of hidden third construct. And so Dijkstra started writing very deeply and thinking quite hard about structured programming, about the ways in which it would be possible to structure programs so that they could be reasoned about. Tony Hoare had produced the axiomatic basis for computer programming, which gave a formal basis to the reasoning. And of course the Simula had appeared, and so the basis for very strong object-oriented programming and modular programming and information hiding had appeared as part of that language design. All this by the late 1960s, early 1970s. Progress was made in the engineering aspects of developing software. The mechanisms, every engineering discipline is a combination of applied science and mature processes that incorporate the learning that the profession has picked up, that other engineers have picked up, and which have been systematized into processes that can then be taught to a new generation of engineers. That's what engineering is. It's applied science embedded in the processes that come out of practical experience. And software was going down that path reasonably successfully. We got Jackson structured programming, for example, which was extraordinarily effective and remarkably widely used during the 1970s. It was taught to school children in Scandinavia very, very widely. It was quite interesting in that the underlying computer science is a lexical analyzer. It's a parser for the data structures, if you view the data structures as a grammar. And I had always assumed that that was how it was designed, that Jackson had actually taken LL1 grammars and parsers for LL1 grammars and had designed a method for developing ordinary commercial data processing software on the basis of writing down the data structures in a grammatical form and then transforming them mechanically into the appropriate recognizer for that data structure. When I finally got around to asking him, he denied it completely. I said it was complete coincidence and that he'd basically invented the techniques completely independently and only realized later that there was this parallel. We got the first practical formal methods, VDM, which I've mentioned, Abrel's work on Z, and these were ways of describing the world that you wanted to write algorithms about using set theory as a basis and using the functional mathematics that goes with being able to describe systems in terms of states, using that basic mathematics and then to be able to do the transformations and to reason about the properties and the consistency of the systems that you were describing. These things were appearing in the 1970s and gaining ground. Right at the end of the 1970s that the European Union, in one of the first research projects, actually got STL to develop a VDM description of the programming, the underlying programming support environment. I can't remember what it was called, but the European Union's research programs were using a common software development environment, and they wanted a formal specification of it. And so a team of people at STL won a project to actually build that. It was that team, when STL closed down the labs, Praxis acquired that team of people. That's how my company, Praxis, in 1963, 1964, acquired the technology for using VDM and an extended form of VDM, VVSL. by actually acquiring that team of people, Tim Denver and his colleagues from STL. So already at that stage, some really quite big systems were being formally specified. We're now middle of 1980s. We had the basis there for really professional software engineering. But this is Dykstra's handwriting, which you probably can't read from where you're sitting. Most programmers still regarded software development as a craft. Dykstra, in one of his famous notes, wrote, "The required techniques of effective reasoning are pretty formal, but as long as programming is done by people that don't master them, the software crisis will remain with us and will be considered an incurable disease." And you know what incurable diseases do? They invite the quacks and the charlatans in, who in this case take the form of software engineering gurus. And of course there were a lot of software engineering gurus in the 1970s and 1980s, peddling all kinds of strange methods for developing software, almost none of which worked, because most of them didn't have a theoretic underpinning. So they didn't give you the ability to reason. They incorporated some good heuristics, but that only took you so far. And we are, after all, building big, complex systems that are intrinsically very fragile, in that, you know, one error in a very large system can render it completely useless. And of course, Moore's Law was running along in the background. And so hardware was accelerating its development at an extraordinary rate, pushing computing out into a much, much wider group of application areas. And that was what drove the adoption of software. It was the cost benefit, the fact that everybody could afford a computer and every application could afford more and more and more computers doing more and more of the task. And so the underlying development of the microprocessor and the way in which microprocessors drove computing out into a lot of embedded systems and also made computing available not just to enterprises with their single mainframe computer serving a whole business, not just to departments with their departmental VAX system perhaps sitting in a corner providing a service to the department, but a computer on every desk, or two computers on every desk. And so lots and lots and lots of computing needing lots and lots of software. But where was it going to come from? Well, it was going to come from the programmers that already existed and a lot more who would get sucked into the industry because we needed a lot more programmers. And it was going to use the tools that already existed, or cut down versions of them, or whatever could be made available. And so people picked up tools that were written for one purpose and used them in another. And you've got languages like C, which was a terrific development when originally put together, what, late 60s in concept, early 70s in its first real form with a compiler written in C, designed for writing Unix, designed to be used by a very small team of people with extraordinary skills in developing algorithms and writing very simple software. Lovely, powerful language for that purpose, really completely unsuited for building million or 5 million line programs where you've got teams of people needing to write software that has to be modular, where you need to be able to enforce contracts between the different modules in order to ensure that people regard the interface as the same, whichever way they're looking across the interface. Simply not the right tool for most of the programming that was being done, even in the 1980s. And yet, still very much a dominant language today. And of course there was a lot of money to be made. And one of the things that you see right through the history of the software industry is the way in which the demand for computer systems that worked well enough really militated against the development of organizations that built high quality software, because the money was to be made in being first to market, in using your customers as your beta testers, in getting something out there, winning the market, being able to say that you were going to achieve particular functionality, even if actually that wasn't what you were delivering it. We as an industry, got a reputation for shelfware, you know, people marketing, and vaporware, people marketing things that didn't exist, people selling things that they couldn't deliver. And what I experienced in working in the software industry and running Praxis in those early days was that if you did the work to really understand the customer's requirements, then firstly, half the time, you were in a position you could talk them out of needing a computer system, because you know, mostly what they'd got was a requirement to understand their business. And by the time you'd analyzed what it was they needed you to write by the way of software, you could explain to them how their business worked, and they took away your report and didn't need any software. We had some spectacular examples of that, where you know, we'd go along and give a presentation to try and win a project, and we'd put up all kinds of charts, and they'd buy the charts, you know, and we wouldn't make a lot of money out of them, and then we wouldn't have a software project. Meanwhile, our competitors on the big projects were deliberately underbidding. It's something I'll come back to, but the principle was that your bid price was as low as it needed to be to make sure you got the contract. And what it was going to cost you to write the software was completely irrelevant, because you knew that the customer had got their requirements wrong. And you knew that once you got the project, they were really over a barrel, and they were going to have to pay you for the change requests which they would need, and that would enable you to manage the project in a way that got you back the profits that you had thrown away by bidding so low in the first place. But of course that stops the good people, like me, from winning the contracts, because the customers couldn't tell that what they were being offered by Company A and Company B were in fact radically different, and that the price that they were being told up front by the good guys was in fact lower than what they would in fact end up paying to the bad guys, probably for an inferior product. But that's not the way it looked, and that's not what they could sell to their finance director, and so they tended to take the plausible low bid rather than the correct higher bid. So it was tricky. And again, just like the first time round, the place where it really started to bite was the defence industry. And I guess that's because defence always has leading edge problems. They're always trying to do things that are bigger, harder, require faster processing, more real time, just generally trickier than industry generally is trying to do. And they've got a whole raft of inhibitions on the way that they, and constraints on the way that they procure things that actually make it quite hard for them to move rapidly to get people to come in and write appropriate software. And so things go badly wrong in the defence industry as an early place where you see crises appearing. And in this particular case, this was the USA. And the Department of Defense was having major difficulties with major software projects. And indeed with not just with safety-based ones, and they were getting enough of those, but with security-based ones too. They'd tried naively to introduce formal methods using a book of requirements for the documentation you needed to deliver called the Orange Book. And the defence contractors were perfectly happy to do what they were told and take the money, and they were literally delivering pantechnicons full of paper-based descriptions with all the mathematics and the formal methods and the stuff that, that the Orange Book required. And of course it was completely useless to anybody because there was nobody in Department of Defence who could understand what on earth they'd got, and there was vastly too much of it to be able to work with it. And one of the lessons of using formal methods is you need to use tools. You know, if you're going to end up trying to prove theorems, you don't want to be doing it by hand, goodness me. You want theorem provers. You need your methods, your notations, in a form that can be machine processed. That led to the SA getting the Software Engineering Institute set up at Carnegie Mellon. And Polk and Bill Curtis and Crises and Weber devised a way in which it would be possible for the Department of Defence to decide which of their contractors were actually competent in writing software. That was the purpose of the capability maturity model. What can we do as a way of finding out before it hurts us and costs us too much whether the people who are bidding to us are actually any good at what they say they're going to do, which is write software for us. So they put together the capability maturity model, and it was, you know, classic five layer model. The first level, the initial level, was essentially chaos. There weren't any documented processes. People weren't trained in them. Companies that managed to develop a certain sort of software successfully couldn't do it again on another project because there was no institutionalized learning, no underlying stability in their software processes. It was chaotic. And then once you'd actually captured your processes and you were able to train people in them, you got to the point where things became repeatable, and then they became defined, and then you got to the point where actually you really had got enough control over your processes that they were managed, and you were starting to measure what worked and what didn't work. And then you started finally to be able to get to the optimizing level where you were using those management measures to feed back into the process in a constant improvement of the underlying processes. 90% of defence contractors were at level one, chaotic. And when the SEI, the Software Engineering Institute, started rolling out the capability and maturity model across industry, 90% or more of all industrial software development was in fact found to be down at the chaotic level. Now, we'd, in the UK, hit the same sort of problem. I'll come on to what we'd done in the UK in a moment, but one of the things that came out of that was a real push towards British Standard 5750, the quality management standard, became ISO 9000, being used as a way of controlling the software development process. And actually, it turns out that an organisation following BS 5750, ISO 9000, in a rigorous way, is positioned at about level three on the capability maturity model. It maps across pretty well against the criteria in the CMM. These are the sort of issues that were arising. These are just to give you an idea of how bad things were. This was the software development for a major aircraft, major American aircraft manufacturer. It's the development of, in fact, I may as well say what it is. It was the Boeing Hercules, the C-130J, big military transport aircraft. And a group at Boscombe Down did an analysis of a lot of the software on that aircraft, and these are the sort of defect rates that they found, and they published it all in Crosstalk, the Journal of Defence Software Engineering. So the worst C modules, they were finding a defect in every two lines of code. The best, when it was auto-code generated from a design, it was getting up to a defect in every between 6 and 38. But the, as you can see, the level of defects, the density of defects in the code was extraordinary. And of course, one of the great things about using testing as your way of convincing yourself that the software is good enough is that you find very early on all the bugs that you're going to hit quite often. And so when you've got an awful lot of defects in the software, what you do is you hoover up all the surface dirt, and you leave all the deeply embedded stuff. So what you end up with is a lot of very high number of really rather obscure defects in the code. And that's a phenomenon that we keep seeing. But just to illustrate just how bad it is, you know, there have been a number of studies over the years. I'll show you another one in just a moment. Looking at how good programmers are at writing software. And it's a rare programmer who doesn't make an error in every 10 lines of code. It's an extraordinarily rare programmer who doesn't make an error in every 100 lines of code. And a modern motor car's got 100 million lines of code in it, and it's not all written by extraordinarily good programmers. These are the sort of defects that were found in that Boscombe-Down study. Undefined values, quite a lot of that. Quite a lot more. RAM corruptions. System runs backwards. This is one of the errors. I pulled this out because it's a nice simple one, and it illustrates another point. This is a bit of Spark code, and it's a bit of Ada code, and it's a trivially easy module. What it's supposed to do is to take in a three-valued input that is either a warning or a caution or an advisory. And what it's supposed to do is to return true, which will lead to a bell ringing, if the input is a warning or a caution. And if it's just an advisory, then it returns false, and it won't ultimately lead the bell to ring. But if you look, you know, it's an if it's warning, if it's advisory, it sets result. And if it's neither of those, it just returns result without setting it. So it picks up something off the stack, which happens to be usually true because of the nature of the code that was lurking around on the stack. And so most times you test this, it'll work fine. Until it doesn't. And it'll stop working as a result of something being changed somewhere completely different in the program that changes the stack layout and means that now that uninitialized variable is actually a Boolean false rather than a Boolean true. And no amount of testing can guarantee to find this. You run it through a static analyzer, it picks it up in an eye blink. But what do people do? They run tests and they become spuriously confident in their software as a result of the test results. What's Humphrey at the Software Engineering Institute? He's written some terrific stuff. It's well worth, ever so much of it's online. Well worth reading. Really good notes. He used to write what is essentially a blog for people internally in the Software Engineering Institute. It's just a whole series of rivetingly good short essays about different topics. Well worth reading. One of the things he did was to actually conduct an experiment. He took 810 experienced software developers and set them some programming tasks, and then looked to see how many defects per 1,000 lines of code were in their code. And on average, it was 120 defects per 1,000 lines of code for this group of experienced software developers the upper 1% was still introducing 11 defects in every 1,000 lines of code. The top 1%. I wish more of these experiments were done. I've looked and I can't find. Must have been very late 80s, I think, this experiment. I haven't seen anybody trying to repeat it. I think that's a great pity, because I think it would be really interesting to repeat these sorts of things and find out whether we've got much better, whether different languages actually give us better defect rates on a consistent way, independent of who's using them. It would be really good to have that studying done. In the UK, we got the STARTS program, initially software tools for application to real-time systems. And later, DTI tried to move this with the help of the National Computing Centre into the IT world for business systems with little success. It was reasonably good. What it did was to drive adoption of ISO 9000 through the software industry in the UK, because the government started putting out contracts where it was mandatory to be certified against ISO 9000. And that was a good thing initially, but it drove a market for ISO 9000 auditors, which was a race to the bottom. Everybody wanted auditors who were going to give them the certificate, no matter how good they were actually at auditing. And therefore, there was a market where if the word got round that you were an easy touch, you got more business than if the word got round that you were good at your job. So inevitably, the standard of people certified against ISO 9000 went down over a period of time. But at least it caused people to write down their processes so that they were at least in a position to be audited. So, you know, they at least started thinking about how we do things around here, and do we train people, and is there a standard way? And that certainly brought some significant benefits. Few companies adopted formal methods, and most companies didn't. And so by the mid-90s, big consultancies in America were starting to get their teeth into the problem. The Standish Group runs a sort of in-house club that you can sign up to, and they do lots of research reports, and you get access to the reports if you remember. And they did a survey of 8,000 application projects in the US. And these are the figures that came out of that survey. A third of them cancelled before delivery. 16% of them were on time, budget, and met the requirements. For every 100 projects, there were 94 restarts in the projects, which is one reason why things were overrunning, of course. Cost overruns and time overruns, typically of the order of 200%. Typically, only two-thirds of the features that were originally specified ever got delivered. This was our industry, the software industry, and this is the mid-90s. You know, we've been going for 40 years by this stage. And this was how good it was. And the reason was the rapid expansion. It was Moore's law that stopped us. It made it too easy to make money, so we didn't need to learn our craft. And we never became an engineering profession. We were a software business that was focused on making money whatever way we could. And so we specialised in picking the low-hanging fruit, in rushing into new application areas and selling people stuff that, well, it looked good, and certainly they bought it, and probably we managed to employ some lawyers that wrote contracts that meant they couldn't sue us afterwards, and that was how you made money. And it was pretty desperate. And then came Y2K. And that was a wake-up call, in a way. I was, by the mid-90s, I was working as a partner in Deloitte too, so I had some international responsibilities for some of the service lines, because Deloitte had had created Deloitte Consulting. So they brought all the consulting groups from the major bits of Deloitte and Touche around the world together into a single body. So those of us who were service line leaders in the jargon had responsibilities internationally. And I was asked to take on year 2000 as alongside the advanced software engineering stuff I was doing. And that was really quite revealing, because you know, I got to talk to a lot of companies and see just how bad it was. I remember on one occasion standing up in front of the divisional directors of a FTSE 100 company in the UK, who was an audit client of Deloitte's at the time, and talking to them about year 2000, and they were expressing concern about their systems. And I asked them how confident that they were that they could actually find the sources for their most critical business systems and rebuild them so that the binaries that were running on their mainframes and departmental computers at the moment would continue to run and continue to support the business. Could you just rebuild the systems without introducing any errors? Nobody said they could. None of the people there had any confidence that they could. And then all the excuses came. Oh, we had this brilliant programmer, and he was really, really good at doing what the users wanted, but he always did it in his own file store, and he's left, and we've no idea where his sources are. And you know, we can't take those modules out of the system because the users really depend on them, but we've no idea how he did it, and you know, he was cleverer than most of our programmers, so we can't even rewrite them. And it's just a picture of a business that has very, very little to do with engineering. You know, this is not an engineering approach to putting in place the systems that support the major part of an organization. And of course, a lot of companies had to sort out some of those problems over Y2K, either by throwing their systems away and buying new ones, which a very large number of people did, or by getting people in to do remediation of their systems in the jargon, and which of course involved finding the source code of the systems and changing it and rebuilding, which at least put things back under control for them at that point. It cost a huge amount of money. Lots and lots of really serious bugs were found. I mean, we found errors in all sorts of organizations which would have been they would have caused serious damage to those organizations if they had not been found. I was told by more than one organization that a single bug that we had found would actually worth the entire cost of their Y2K program to have got that out before it actually materialized in real life. So there was, you know, it was a big problem and a big effort. And of course, the underlying problem was that we had a single point of failure for a lot of diverse systems. And there's a lesson there that we haven't learned, because if there's something that can go wrong that can cause a lot of different systems to fail at the same time, the chaos that can cause is much bigger than you're likely to be able to handle as an organization, as a country even. And yet, we keep not putting in place the processes that would help us to avoid making that mistake. We got away with it in Y2K for a number of reasons. Firstly, there was a big effort that went in. Secondly, there was the fact that a lot of systems were inevitably going to fail, not right on the millennium cutover minute, but at various times beforehand where they first encountered dates that were actually now out of range. And so actually we were getting failures back in the 1980s, you know, library booking systems where the return dates suddenly turned out to be in the past rather than in the future. Or one of the classics was expiry dates on some tins of essentially non-perishable goods that needed to go through these goods inward process in Sainsbury's supermarket and broke the system because the expiry date was in the past because it was in the next century. So a lot of systems did fail, but they failed early, and because they were failing one at a time, it wasn't a problem. They got fixed. A lot of damage was caused by people replacing systems, and then the replacement systems overrunning. It nearly brought, well, it did bring down a major utility in Australia. The complete board of directors had got fired as a consequence because the utility company had to be bailed out by the state government because it had completely run out of money. It was incapable of issuing sensible bills and processing the cash when it came in, and then its call handling centre went down because it was just swamped with people trying to get through, and it was horrible. But they lost their complete board of directors over it, and that was, as I say, because there wasn't Y2K compliant, and then they made the mistake of listening to the consultants who told them that they ought to spend the money on buying a new system rather than making the old one work. And then the new system was late. And now we're in the 21st century. We're still writing software in the main without a formal specification. Almost all the V&V is being done using testing. We've got millions of new programmers writing apps, most of them with no training in computer science or software engineering. Very little understanding of computer security. And software's getting bigger. I find those numbers scary. And you can't write that amount of software on the timescales for a new car. That's lines of code down the right there. Yeah, lines of code. You can't write 100 million. You know, most of that software is copied from somewhere else. Most web designers copy stuff off the web. They find another website that looks as though it's doing the right sort of thing, and they go and look at the source and they steal it. And so bugs propagate. Vulnerabilities on one website appear somewhere else. If you find a vulnerability on one website, you know, take a chunk of their code and Google for it. You'll find the vulnerability on other people's websites too. It's, you know, if you're a hacker and you want to break into places, good way of finding where the bugs have spread to. If you want to create bugs so that you can exploit them, get into the business of putting up open source software libraries with obscure bugs in. You know, people come in droves and copy your code because it's so much easier than writing their own. And if you've got Google Analytics running, you even know who they are and where they've put it, and you know, you're home. You've actually injected your errors into their software. How many programmers have we got? Too many, arguably. 18 million, I mean. I can't believe there's any other engineering profession that can claim that number of people working in it, and certainly most of those people are not engineers. And so we have a third software crisis. We've built a society on top of a software infrastructure that won't bear the weight. And we're seeing it in all sorts of ways. I mean, the National Security Council says that hostile attacks on UK cyberspace by other states and large-scale cybercrime is a tier one threat. They put it alongside international military crisis, international terrorism, or a major accident or natural hazard that requires a national response, such as a severe nationwide flooding. That's how serious the weaknesses in our software are, just from the point of view of them being exploited by criminals or foreign states or terrorists. Never mind the ordinary errors, this is the security side of the problem. And we've seen, you know, bad software causes a lot of damage. You know, even some of the early worms, Code Red and Slammer and Melissa, each caused over $1 billion worth of damage. Microsoft took, they had a team of, I don't know, 20 or 30 people just getting one of these worms out of one network in one of their major international clients in South America. Huge problems because of bad software. These worms are only successful because they're exploiting errors in the software or bad designs in the software. And you know, it's bad when a system fails, but when you can exploit it, you end up with this sort of problem. You know, the stage fright attack on Android smartphones, a vulnerability that exists in 950 million, nearly a billion platforms around the world. And you know, it got a lot of publicity at the time. And it caused a lot of people to reissue lots and lots of software, but an awful lot of Android systems never got fixed. This vulnerability is still very, very widespread because a lot of organizations, a lot of devices that use Android don't regularly push out the fixes to the people who are using them. And then the attack code was publicized, which of course made life even easier for people who wanted to exploit it. And we're finding these sorts of errors, as you would expect, turning up in some pretty vulnerable places. And there've been some serious problems in software for cars. It's well worth looking at this reference. This is the Michael Barr's expert report in the American court case over the uncommanded acceleration of a particular model of Toyota cars. And according to Barr, he looked at the throttle control system code. They said that they had written the code conforming to MISRA-C programming standards. He found more than 80,000 violations of the MISRA-C standard in the code that he looked at. He found buffer overflow, invalid pointer dereferencing, stack overflow. He found that critical tasks could die and the watchdog timer that was supposed to be there detecting it wouldn't detect it. So there was a lot of evidence that the errors that he found could have caused uncommanded acceleration. And I believe the case was won, and Toyota lost, and they had to recall and compensate and do lots of remedial work. And there've been others. You know, the Odyssey vans have been recalled for a software bug. Just very recently, a software error that has been stopping airbags from deploying in accidents has caused the recall of a very large number of vehicles just in the last week or two. And it just goes on. There's another one, again, you know, fairly recent. Diagnostic dongles that are used for insurance purposes, and it was demonstrated that you could take control of the car by breaching the network there. Caused again expensive recalls and updates. Happens in hospitals. This is a US Food and Drug Administration recall and alert for problems in infusion pumps, you know, the things that deliver drugs into intravenous drips in hospitals in a controlled way. There are ever so many problems in medical systems, not just security problems, but egregiously bad human-computer interfaces. Researchers at the University of Swansea, Harold Thimbleby's team, have found and in fact been involved in court cases where staff in the hospital have been disciplined, lost their jobs because they appear to have given a patient the wrong dose and injured them. And he's been able to demonstrate that actually it could perfectly easily have been the fault of the interface to the equipment, which was simply not displaying things in a way that enabled you to see what you'd actually put in and to spot mistakes and to correct them if necessary. I believe one of the nurses who was prosecuted and then lost her job even committed suicide because she felt so guilty about having been accused and found guilty of killing a patient. These sorts of vulnerabilities need to be sorted out, but we don't have a mechanism, unfortunately, for doing that yet. Websites get hacked. I mean, this was a classic. This is the American Office of Personnel Management managed to lose all their personnel records. Some hacker stole them, including the digitized fingerprints of all the people who had ever had a security clearance in America. Then there are the Ashley Madison website. You know, life is short, have an affair, lots of people signed up to this, and then an attacker group grabbed the code and the data from the website and stuck it on the web. It turned out that most of the people who had been signing up to this were men. They were paying to have conversations with the small number of women that were on the site. Turned out that actually they weren't women, they were chatbots that had been set up to a significant extent anyway. There may have been some women there, but there were certainly a lot of chatbots that were running and charging money, or at least according to the press reports. I haven't looked at the code myself, obviously. ruined a huge number of relationships, of course, and again caused some suicides. And there's a lot of problems. You can see why this is genuinely a current day crisis. Lots of data exposed. Of course, in the UK, you don't need to hack into it. You can just buy it, unfortunately. Under some circumstances, criminals go where the money is, and cybercrime is easy at the moment. We saw that when I was on the Serious Organised Crime Agency. You know, there's nothing special about cybercrime. It's just crime where the criminals have moved online because it's frauds and extortion and all the classic crimes, which turn out to be both more lucrative and a hell of a sight safer for the criminals if you do them online than if you try to turn up in a corner news agent with a chunk of lead bar. I mean, cybercrime is the easy way to make money if you're a criminal, unfortunately, and it is too easy. And the lessons are not being learned. This is the first page of a memo from the head of test and evaluation for the F-35, the latest American fighter, writing to the Under Secretary of Defense, and the memo got leaked. And he says, the current official schedule to complete full development and testing of all the Block 3F capabilities particular stage in the development, by the 31st of July next year, is unrealistic. It could be achieved only by eliminating a significant number of currently planned test points, tripling the rate at which weapons delivery events have historically been conducted, and deferring resolution of sufficient operational deficiencies to Block 4. In fact, I learned very recently the program is currently considering reducing by two-thirds the number of planned delivery events as specified in the test and evaluation master plan. If we follow this, it constitutes a very high risk of failing initial operational test and evaluation. You know, so most of the validation is being done by testing. They're running into problems, of course. And the response to overrunning the timescales is to curtail even the amount of testing they're doing. So not only are they using the wrong technique for assuring themselves of the quality of their software and finding the defects, but they're actually reducing the amount of that they're using because they can't do it fast enough. And that's on the latest fighter plane. The TalkTalk attack. I want to talk about that very, very briefly because it was an SQL injection. And we've known about SQL injections forever. This is how they work. You know, a web page asks for a username and I type in Thomas and it gets dropped into an SQL statement. Select user details from the table users where the uname is what I've just typed in. But if you do that and you don't sanitize the data that has been put in there, you can drop in a bit of SQL pretending it's your username. So if I type semicolon to close off the initial SQL statement, and then an SQL statement like drop table users as my username, what actually happens is that I delete the user table in the database rather than giving them a username. And you can use exactly the same trick for injecting SQL into lots and lots of interfaces. The other big one is overflows, buffer overflows. And you know, if you look at how you're advised to copy strings, you know, you're told to be careful if you're using something like string copy in C, to avoid overflows, make sure you're not copying something that's too big to go in the buffer. Because the problem is that if you've got a bit of C code that has got a character buffer in it that you're copying something into, you end up with a stack frame that looks like this, where you've got your buffer and the buffer is growing that way, the stack is growing that way, which means that the return address in this stack frame is just where the buffer, if you write more into it than it will take, just overwrites it. So you can overwrite that return address. And then when you exit from the function, you jump to wherever you have overwritten. And so if you craft it carefully, you can stick a bit of malicious code here, and you can make sure that the code that you put there jumps to it. And of course, it's hard to get that right because you don't know exactly the memory layout of the system you're attacking. So you pack around your malicious code with a great wodge of a few thousand no-op instructions so that if you hit it anywhere in there, it'll simply run through into your malicious code, and that makes it very easy. These buffer overflow attacks and other sorts of overflow attacks and other sorts of injection attacks are so well known, and they are all the problem. You know, the reason why the vulnerability is there is bad coding at a very simple level. And yet they're everywhere. I mean, if you look at the, you go to the exploit database on the web. And in this particular case, I did a search for exploits on overflows. 3,471 documented. In most cases, verified. They've actually checked out that they really work. They'll tell you what the particular application is, and they'll give you the attack code that they use to demonstrate that it worked. And it's just, you know, 3,400 examples of buffer overflows sitting there. There are about 4,800 from memory SQL injection exploits in the same database, and lots more. And this attack was a buffer overflow. This attack on a car was just a buffer overflow. You can attack physical systems. Anything that's got a digital data interface is potentially vulnerable to a buffer overflow attack. Your digital radio can be attacked through buffer overflow. And the digital radio in your car is probably on the same bus as the throttle control and the steering and the brakes, because the car manufacturers haven't learnt about separation of function. And self-evident, you would think, but people don't do that. And the key point is, if you've got continuous behavior, you can interpolate between test results. So if you're testing an ordinary balance weighing machine, you know, you can check that it works for 1 gram and 100 grams and know that it works for all the grams in between. If you're testing a digital one, you can't. As NPL found out when they tried to certify computer controlled weighing machines in the early days and discovered that there were spot weights for which they gave the wrong answers. Because you can't interpolate between the test results, because digital systems are a set of discrete states. They don't exhibit continuous behavior in general. And if you want to be able to reason that in your particular case they do, you're going to need a formal statement of the language anyway. And if you've got that so you can reason about whether the behavior is continuous, you don't need to do the tests. You can prove that they haven't got the errors you're looking for. And there are companies that are using formal methods. I mean, the latest air traffic control system in the UK, IFACTS, was built with a Z specification, 250,000 lines of Z. It generated 750,000 proof obligations, individual mathematical proofs that had to be proved to show that the system could not fail at runtime. No overflows, for no input can it fail at runtime. No memory leaks, can't run out of stack space. No possibility of it failing at runtime. 750,000 proofs to carry out. When they make a change to that software, they need to repeat all that analysis. It takes 15 minutes on a four-processor desktop computer, £2,000 desktop computer. Make a change to the IFACTS code, go and have a cup of coffee, run the examiner on it. By the time you've finished your coffee, proofs have been repeated. Because the proofs are not context dependent, so you can cache them. So it's only actually the proofs that have changed that actually need to be reproved, and very few of them will have done. So it doesn't take very long. They call it regression proving, by analogy with regression testing. It's very quick and very effective. And people like Facebook, you know, the people who boast move fast and break things is their software development methodology. They're using formal methods now as part of their development process because it works. And they bought Monoidics in order to get the tools and the expertise of the computer scientists that they needed in order to get those methods into their development processes. So, These are the lessons we haven't learned. And somehow, we need as an industry, as a profession, to get these messages across. Because no, your profession is, by definition, I think, a profession has to learn from its mistakes. No, nobody will ever make no bridge developer will ever build a wobbly footbridge making the same mistakes as were made on the Millennium Footbridge. Or a Tacoma Narrows bridge. They won't make those mistakes again because the models have changed. And now the underlying models that are used don't contain the defects of ignoring the lateral forces in people walking across bridges that enabled that to happen. Can you think of a single thing where you could say no competent person in software development will ever make that mistake again? I keep asking audiences, I'm still waiting for somebody to come up with a convincing example of something that we've learned as a profession in the 40 or 50 years we've been going. And you know, Lord Benson criteria for being a profession, controlled by a governing body, well, which in professional matters directs the behaviour of its members. You could argue, I suppose, that the BCS does that. Set adequate standards of education as a condition of entry. Ensure that they obtain an acceptable standard of professional competence and CPD. Well, it's offered. I'm not sure I don't know anymore, but I don't think the BCS would throw you out if you stopped doing CPD. Must set ethical rules and professional standards that must be higher than those established by law. That one's questionable, I think. I'm not sure that's the case. It must be for the benefit of the public, not for the private advantage of the members. Must take disciplinary action, if necessary, expulsion from membership, if or should a member be guilty of bad professional work. I don't think anybody's ever been thrown out of the BCS for being incompetent at their business. Yeah, I don't think in general professional societies are following the rules laid down here and actually exercising the powers that they ought to. It's a good set of aspirations, I think. And here we are. You know, why? This is Tony Hall's view as to why, by analogy, why we haven't learnt the lessons. He says he takes the analogy with the barber surgeons of earlier ages, who prided themselves on the sharpness of their knives and the speed with which they dispatched their duty, whether it was shaving a beard or amputating a limb. Imagine the dismay with which they greeted some ivory-towered academic who told them that the practice of surgery should be based on a long and detailed study of human anatomy, on familiarity with surgical procedures pioneered by great doctors of the past, and that it should be carried out only in a strictly controlled, bug-free environment, far removed from the hair and dust of the normal barber's shop. That feels like a really good analogy with where we are today, and that's why people don't want to listen, because they don't want to change, because it would be totally disruptive to the way they're working.
To learn from the experience of in Vienna with sepsis in childbirth, at least as long as we take to learn this. I'm not using that as an excuse.
No.
I'm just saying it's probably a feature of human nature.
Absolutely. But the thing about every previous engineering profession, and perhaps every previous profession, is that it took a very long time for it to really permeate throughout society and for a very large part of society to become critically dependent on it.
Moore's law conflicts with human culture.
Yes.
Is the problem.
Yes.
In a nutshell.
Yes. And so that's the problem we need to find a solution to. We need to find a way of accelerating the way in which our craft matures into an engineering profession that actually matches the speed of change of the underlying technology that is driving the take-up of the work that we're producing. I think the situation that we're in is essentially unsustainable. We're under huge pressure to put more and more weight on these foundations of software, because society wants smart cities and driverless cars and more apps on the smartphone and more automation in hospitals and autonomous systems to use in warfare and robots in health in care homes and lots and lots and lots of technology in critical areas which actually our industries are not competent to build. So what should a professional society do about that problem? That's the question I want to throw open to you, and thank you for tolerating me talking for so long.
I'd like to make a comment, thank you.
Please.
Hang on just for a second so we can move the back. Is that working?
I was going to say, well, would you like one of mine? I've got two.
My wife used to work for you, but afterwards, she was director of IT for a quite substantial housing association. She carried them through 2000. The board meeting following 2000, members of the board turned and said, well, that was a lot of fuss about nothing, Jenny, wasn't it? And I think our success on over Y2K, and it was, damaged our credibility with ordinary business and organisational management.
Yeah.
They thought, these people are making a damn great fuss about nothing. My own current organisation had to change for anti-Arguses in nuclear power stations. Another fun task.
Yeah.
You know, but afterwards, oh, you were obviously making a fuss about nothing, weren't you? Man flu.
Yes, there was, of course, a lot of corrupt behaviour by companies. I can remember, I was the ultimate safety net for National Air Traffic Services. I was auditing their Y2K programme. And they were being told by people that, you know, they weren't prepared to give an assurance that the fan heaters wouldn't fail on Y2K. And there was a real fuss about the transformer, you know, NATs, when they were at West Drayton, they used to run entirely on diesel power using the grid as a backup because it guaranteed that they'd got a highly reliable backup for their electricity service. So they got some really big diesel generators. They couldn't get the manufacturers to give them Y2K certification on the diesel generators. Those diesel generators didn't have a clock in them. They certainly didn't have a calendar in them. How could they possibly fail as a result of a Y2K bug? I mean, most of the aviation industry was panicking, but actually almost all systems on aircraft, the most they know about the time is the time of day and whether the forecast landing time is today or tomorrow. So there's a bit for which day you're talking about. They don't contain calendars. There was never any prospect of most of those systems failing as a result of a Y2K problem. But people were forced to upgrade all kinds of bits of kit because the auditors required the certificates and the manufacturers and consultants saw it as a way of making money. So there was a lot of seriously dishonest things that happened, and you can understand companies being cross about it. But actually the software industry, in my opinion, did a bloody good job. And we got away with it, as I said, firstly because systems were never going to all fail at once, but in any case, the cascade failures that we worried about didn't happen because the systems weren't as tightly coupled as we thought they were. And that's another lesson we haven't learned, because we're now coupling the systems more and more and more tightly together in the interest of efficiency and not taking care to ensure that we invest in the resilience, which to an accountant looks like redundancy and something that can be cut out to save money.
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned NAV, because NAV Canada did have a year 2K problem. On the 29th of February, yeah. NAV sent NAV Canada a message. Here are the oceanic tracks for the 29th of February. And NAV Canada, what? Because they assumed that year 2K was a
leap
year exception.
Yeah. And there was another one too. There was another one too that we missed, which was the runway visual range systems that actually give you the warning of how much visibility you've got on the ground. They routinely call back in to the main station to do a handshake at 4 o'clock in the morning, just as a standard update cycle. And 4 o'clock in the morning of the 1st of January, they called back in, found that the base system clock and the runway visual range system clock were not in correspondence, and did what they were programmed to do and shut down. So the runway visual range shut down all the next airports across the country 4 o'clock in the morning on 1st of January. But I mean, it didn't make any difference because nobody was flying. we had an emergency room set up in NATS. And we got a call approaching midnight from the air traffic controls in Scotland saying all our radars have failed. And they hadn't, it was just there weren't any aircraft, no targets.
Early on in your talk, you were talking about the software crisis, and you mentioned the hardware very briefly, and saying, well, that's all right, that's very reliable. But I don't think we should exonerate it that easily. For example, to take your stack problem and the hacking of the hardware above a stack, perhaps some of the problem is due to the linear stores that we have. Now, I don't know whether John Ireland is here, but I mean, he was due to give a talk some time ago. Is he here?
Yeah.
Hello, John. you might remember me. Give the microphone to John. many years ago, he, in his basic machine architecture, would have had a stack that was protected by a base and limit register at a hardware level. If you tried to do anything underhand like that, you would get hardware interrupt straight away. So you couldn't do that sort of thing if you had the right sort of hardware. Maybe we should be concentrating as well on the hardware, getting better architectures as well as software.
Oh, absolutely. Although it's worth pointing out that early versions of the Intel chipset had levels of protection, you know, sort of Multics-style protection levels, and the programmers wouldn't use them because they slowed the machine down because of the context switching. And so they basically abandoned writing software that way because of efficiency concerns. I mean, some of these problems could be solved by better cooperation between hardware designers and software designers, but actually we could solve them all in the software. So why don't we do the things that we know how to do?
Right.
Are we not making a lot of our own bets in some way with the way we're spreading the use of processors? You know, do you need a microprocessor in your fridge? We order them for you, you know, and networking to that extent. Are we not making things worse by automating things that possibly don't need to be automated?
Yes, but that's just another symptom of the same problem that I was talking about, that there is money to be made from selling people features and much less money to be made from actually selling them things that are guaranteed to work. I mean, one of the things that really drives me crazy, why have we managed to develop data formats for things like sending people text documents and pictures that are capable of running code? Why can you embed JavaScript in a PDF document or in a JPEG file and execute it? Who actually needs that functionality? And yet, that's the way in which so many of bits of malware that cause us problems actually get sent around the place. Why do we give people email clients where it is the norm to send people attachments, it is the norm to embed URLs to websites in your emails, and then spend fortunes trying to educate people not to open the attachments and not to click on the links? Why don't we give them tools that they can use safely the way they were designed to be used, rather than giving them things that are unsafe to use and not fixing the underlying problem and then blaming the users for using them the way they were designed to be used? It's outrageous.
I confess to be deeply depressed by your presentation.
Excellent.
I was wondering, I understand that if best practice was disseminated completely, that a lot of these difficulties would be avoided. But if I conferred upon you the total power to reform and to regulate the entire software industry, is there still a residual logical problem about exhaustive and completely reliable testing, given, say, for instance, Gerdon's theorem? I mean, is this a soluble problem ultimately, even if all the deficiencies of best practice were removed?
Well, you used the word testing, which I will ignore because that isn't, you know, as I say, I think testing in terms of assurance is actually a category mistake. It's just a tool that can't deliver the results you're looking for. Can you verify complex software completely? Well, you can prove certain stated properties about it, and if those properties are enough for you, then you can do the job and you can do it completely. I don't think you're going to get bitten by Girdle over issues like that, and even if you are, it's a very minor problem. So, you know, if we can solve all but a millionth of our task by going down a particular path, if we could solve 99% of it, I'd be over the moon. So I'm not concerned about theoretical weaknesses of that nature? I mean, the people have concerns about the compatibility between the mathematical foundations of different formal methods that you may wish to combine in order to generate a proof. And they're legitimate concerns for mathematicians. They're not legitimate concerns for engineers. You know, show me an engineer who uses maths at that level of detail and worries about it, and I'll show you an academic. So, you know, let's get as good as other engineers are at using the science that's relevant to their discipline and really embedding it in properly robust engineering processes. And I think we'll crack the problem that way. How you crack it, I think we have to use economics. If you look at, there have been areas of the world, of you know, application domains, where we have changed behaviour by imposing strict liability on manufacturers. And I think we could do it here if we gave people enough warning. If you sell children's toys in the EU, for example, you are strictly liable if those toys are dangerous and injure the child, unless the state of the art could not have found that vulnerability at the time when you either imported the toys into the EU or built them in the EU. You as the manufacturer or importer have a strict liability. We could do that for security vulnerabilities in software, but we need to give the industry 10 years notice that it was coming so that they could adapt. But why don't we do it? It would be brilliant. And UK companies would win a very substantial chunk of the business that would come out of that, because we're actually good at using strong software engineering tools, better than most companies in the world.
Going back to your point about embedding programming abilities into bits of file, yeah, and making people change things, there was a story, nothing to do with software, with old people's homes, where they were being delivered slightly sophisticated baths which had thermostats on them, but out of the manufacturer they were always set on absolute hot. So when the plumber pumped it in, yes, wired it all up, great, ran a bath, first old person got scalded, they learned to set them to, after they'd been tested in the factory or whatever, to set to cold, and you have to turn them up, not turn them down.
Yeah.
That relates back to what you were just saying about
Yeah, we
not having the default state simple.
Yes, and some of those things are being got right now. So, you know, by default now, quite a lot of operating systems are delivered with most of the services turned off. So you have to actually turn them on if you want to use them, rather than, you know, Windows and even Linux used to turn up with most of the services that it could run active and running. And if you didn't know what the default password, if you did know what the default passwords were, you could hack into them, unless people had thought both either to turn them off or change the passwords. At least to a degree, we're managing to get those defaults right now.
Stack Overflow here. I can see David, Kevin, then Delvin, then Alan.
Well, firstly, a comment, not quite on Stack Overflow, but Buffer Overflow. It often occurred to me that if they changed the C compiler so the stack grew in increasing address rather than decreasing address, a lot of the Buffer Overflow problems would disappear overnight. But I feel, on a more perhaps serious note, the tendency for software systems to have a self-update over the net, to be constantly calling home to the supplier, is leading to a new software crisis in which the software that's put in the field doesn't have to be all that good now, because you can almost fix it, and it's led to a change in attitude. My television is constantly calling back to Samsung, supposedly to fix itself, but so far as I can see, just to produce another defect.
Yeah, I'm very, very valid points. The fact that we have to give the software that we run the right to update itself means that we're not in control of what's running on our computers anymore. And yet, if some illegal content is found on our computers, we will be held accountable for that. That there are a whole range of things where we expect users to behave in a particular way and to take responsibility for certain things, and then we take away their ability to do that. That there are a lot of problems here that need to be thought through properly.
Yes, I think my question was the points about the development of software and the microprocessor and so on, which undermines some of the formal methods, was also, if you remember, early Windows systems and probably DOS as well, they had disclaimers on the operating system not to be used for anything that's safety critical or security.
Yep.
And I'm sure those are probably still sitting in the Windows relative things, but of course they've been expanded over the decades to use for all sorts of things. I mean, Windows has been used for nuclear power plants, and I'm quite sure, at least not directly under control, but probably interacting with it. And that whole underlying thing was no liability on a software developer, which is a very American thing.
Yeah.
And that's the one, you know, you get liability around the world on the software developers the same way you've got on engineers building bridges or manufacturing the moving parts of cars.
Yeah, I mean, when the original product liability laws were brought in the UK in the 1980s, the Computer Services Association, as it then was, fought very hard to stop software being defined as a product. They argued that software was a service, that it wasn't a product, and therefore it wasn't covered by the legislation, because the major manufacturers, who were the members of the Computer Services Association, were terrified of the liability. And you still get pushback in that kind of way. And when the Ministry of Defence introduced Defence Standard 0055 that required formal methods for critical systems in MOD systems, there was a very strong attempt by the industry to kill that standard before it ever actually got published. And it was only, in fact, the BCS under Jim Brooks fighting that battle and sending somebody along to the meeting. And the fact that David Bean, who was my co-founder of Praxis, was actually running the Computer Services Association at the time and went along to that meeting, that we headed off the attempt by industry to kill that standard.
You mentioned earlier on that generally hardware is quite reliable and yet software is quite volatile. Well, I think it's worth reflecting on that statement, because as anyone who develops hardware nowadays knows, it's basically software. The languages that we use for hardware development, VHDL, Verilog, are no more capable of being mathematically proved than any normal software programming languages are. And yet it is true that most hardware that makes it to market does not contain critical vulnerabilities, critical problems, and so on. Of course, there have been high-profile bugs like the infamous floating point. But these are few and far between. You certainly don't find errors in the hardware code of the rate of 10 every 100 lines or anything ridiculous like that. So I wonder what your thoughts are on why it is that the embedded and hardware development managed to solve this problem and get the software.
They use formal methods very heavily because the economics are different. If you get hardware wrong, it's going to be jolly hard to download a patch for it typically. So, you know, the cost of having to redo the masks and reissue new versions of a chip, for example, is sufficiently high that they're prepared to invest a lot more in the development process. And formal method techniques like model checking were used much more widely in hardware before they really started to be used significantly in software.
So this basically implies that it isn't really a technical issue, it is a luxury and
economics.
Cultural issue.
Yeah. Yeah.
So these problems could be solved if we wanted to.
Yes, absolutely. We've got worked examples. I mean, there was an experiment carried out by the National Security Agency for a system called Tokeneer, which if you look it up on the web, you'll actually find a complete description of it, including all the code, all the proofs, and all the tools that you need to run the code and the proofs. If you wanted to download it, you can rebuild it yourself, all free. And that was an experiment. Again, it was in fact done by a team at Praxis to develop a secure system, very small secure system for the National Security Agency as a demonstrator of the correct by construction approach that uses a formal specification and then Spark as an implementation language and the Spark examiner doing deep static analysis and proof. And at the end of that, the National Security Agency tried to find bugs in it and couldn't find any. They sent it down to Albuquerque to be broken. They couldn't find any defects in it at all. And the National Security Agency then looked at the time it had taken and the costs and the amount of code. They said that this was the highest productivity they had ever seen on any software project that had ever been carried out for the National Security Agency. So it had been produced to the highest security standards, and yet it was far more productive than the stuff that the industry was delivering using their standard development techniques. And that's not surprising, because most of the cost of developing software is actually in finding, removing the bugs that you've introduced that you didn't catch early enough in the development process. So better can be cheaper.
A slightly different question. Department of Health has recently announced a substantial investment in rolling out gadgets and apps for personal use in monitoring ongoing health situations at a personal level. Would you yourself wear such an online connected gadget?
I think there are some serious concerns there. I mean, if to the extent that these things are life critical, they're certainly not built and certified to carry that kind of responsibility. And of course, they're collecting a lot of privacy sensitive data, which is then being distributed. And therefore, you do have to worry about where that data is going, who's got access to it, what the implications are. Do you care? It's not clear to me that the people who will be using these gadgets could legitimately be said to have given informed consent for the use of the software and the processing of the data, because I don't think they will have been given enough information to be able to take a really informed decision. And under the forthcoming General Data Protection Regulation, that will be a problem, because it will be against the law. So we're going to run into some interesting challenges if any group of people decide to bring an action under that General Data Protection Regulation in the future. We may get some court rulings that actually turn out to make an awful lot of the systems that we use currently illegal. And who knows, maybe that will be the catalyst for a real shake-up in these sort of areas. I hope so.
You asked earlier, or you mentioned earlier, about promoting professionalism. Lord Benson's principles number 8 skirts around principle number 3 in Jacques' list, Jacques being standard reference professionalism, in that the practitioner's primary responsibility is to the client, customer, patient, rather than to the employer. Now, when I was at medical school, this was drummed into us in a big way. And it was routine except in practice until the introduction of the internal market, when the employer became dominant. And this led to the obscenity of the GMC, the General Medical Council's trial of Mr. Wishart, the general surgeon, the pediatric surgeon at Bristol. And he had been the first person to point out that the facilities at the Bristol Hospital were not up to standard for his pediatric heart surgery. However, under the internal market, the pen pushers were on top. Doctors were then on tap. The disaster which Wishart forecast came to pass. And the General Medical Council, having no power to discipline the Bristol Hospital Trust, hung Wishart out to dry and crucified him publicly.
Yes.
To get professionalism, you've got to move the practitioner's responsibility towards the client, customer, patient, but away from the employer. That would be exceedingly difficult. I would say it's impossible. Forget professionalism.
Yes, I take your point, and that's a good example and well worth reminding yourself. In the context of that, it's worth remembering that the Health and Safety at Work Act, which now I'm a director of the HSE, I'm intimately familiar with, of course, 1974 Health and Safety at Work Act imposes a series of general duties when safety at work is concerned, health and safety at work. And if the Bristol Hospital wasn't providing equipment that was safe to use, then I think a lawyer could perhaps have found a way of bringing an action under the Health and Safety at Work Act. It would certainly have been worth looking into.
But the professional supervisory body, the General Medical Council, which is Lord Benson's advocate,
sure,
the governing body, could do nothing about the failure of the Bristol Hospital Trust to provide the necessary facilities, not necessary equipment, facilities. That failure would be Wishart being the first person to.
Yeah, well, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know to what extent they would have been able to go through an appropriate regulator, but if they couldn't find a regulator who had the legal authority to do that, the overarching responsibility comes back to the, back then it probably would have been the Health and Safety Commission, but now the Health and Safety Executive. So, you know, it's always worth phoning up the inquiry line and giving them a push to see whether there's some action that can be taken. It's an interesting challenge. I mean, we have a real problem with the critical national infrastructure and with a significant part of the national infrastructure that's not critical, because a lot of industrial control systems were written at a time when the security threat was not recognised as a significant threat. And if you look at the international standards for developing safety critical systems, they don't mention security. The software areas simply haven't kept up with the rate of change in the environment as well as the rate of change in technology. So we have a real problem that we have a critical national infrastructure that is largely in the hands of the private sector. We have a Centre for the Protection of National Infrastructure, which has no enforcement powers. And we have a significant amount of that infrastructure, which may very well contain vulnerabilities. I'm not saying that it does, but it may very well contain vulnerabilities. I would expect that it does, just statistically. And there are search engines on the website. Showdown is the classic. Which enable you to find vulnerable systems by running particular focused searches. I mean,
thank you.
So maybe you feel even more depressed now.
It's my turn to ask you a question. Old friends, we are from way back. You mentioned the
old friends. I used to work for you.
We're still friends, I hope. Anyway, you mentioned the work we did with BCS, CSA on the software, etc. And of course, BCS was very active in the Computer Misuse Act, getting that on the statute, but we did a lot of work both politically and with the technology of it all. You asked the question, what can the BCS do next in this issue? Because a fascinating story again, a lecture this afternoon, and I'm just about another few percent more worried than I was before I started today. But what can we do? I mean, the general directive on data protection is coming up, may be a vehicle. I think BCS and possibly other professional bodies might be able to work here. One of the things that the cultural difference between the corporate captains, the chief execs and chairmen of industry and commerce that use technology, just try and disengage, as has been said several times. IT seems as a different culture, a funny lot of people that do funny things with technology. What we've got to do is to try and get the chief executives and chairmen aware of the issues of information integrity, information security. It's the lifeblood of their business. We did a lot of work on safety critical systems, both in BAT and then latterly when I was at the BCS and the Safety Critical Systems Club. I tried to follow that up with DTI to get a business critical systems thing going to address some of these issues. But I wonder whether this general directive, which seems to put some onus on chairman and chief executive of big corporations and other big companies, to pay attention to the issues of information security. Is there some way that the BCS might be able to get involved with maybe other professional bodies to lobby the government to try and encourage us all to become more effective?
My guess is that you'll have no problems getting the BCS to engage in a campaign to make people aware of what the obligations are under that. If you wanted to go further and actually try and push companies into doing things that were going to cost them a lot of money and change the way they worked, my guess is the BCS would run scared, because the BCS does not like antagonising rich people. It doesn't have the resources that it would need in order to be able to fight those battles. And so the BCS has always been more interested in membership than in engineering, unfortunately.
A substantial segment of programmes these days are self-employed, not in the sense of contract self-employed, but self-employed in the sense that they design, produce and market their products independently of the industry. I've doubted that many of them are members of the BCS. And most of them have quite substantial capabilities in applications, system design, so on. Surely, in order to crack the problem of those, in particular, probably other areas as well, we need to construct tools that actually make it easy for the program verification that you've spoken of, and that is not an easy thing to do. I learned quite a lesson from the rise and demise of the CORBA distributed software system, which was designed to ensure that when we built distributed systems, which of course the internet is the outstanding example, that it would be possible to verify that at least the interfacing of the modules was done consistently, because it required that there was a specification and that was checked at the time the system was integrated. The world didn't adopt it. The internet grew at a fantastic pace. The demand for software to run on the internet grew and was also hugely more diverse than anybody imagined that it would be when the CORBA system, which was very prominently considered as being a solution. We just completely misjudged the scale at which software would be required on the internet. You mentioned 18 million programmers, and how are we going to get 18 million professional programmers who understand this problem? Just one more remark, which is, you mentioned that certain of the big software-based companies like Microsoft and Google and Facebook have begun to use verification. I know that they have. I'm not a theoretician, so I don't know much about the detail, but I do know that they're doing the verification with programs written in the languages that exist today. They're not requiring that the software is rebuilt in more rigidly typed, strongly typed languages, for example. They're doing it on C programs. And how do they do that? I don't have a good insight, but I suspect you can actually do quite a lot of verification if you go down to the level of modeling the execution environment as well as the programs. I think that's probably what they do.
Yes, so there are a number of tools that do a moderately good job working on languages like C. The problem is a question of soundness. You can't guarantee you'll find all the errors, and you can't guarantee that all the errors that you find will be real errors, so you get a lot of false alarms as well.
If you know which compiler and which hardware it's running on, then you can verify the execution model.
Yes. Yes. So there are certainly steps that can be taken in that way. I mean, the number of different barriers that there are to fixing this problem. But what's the alternative? You know, the way I think about it is, if you project yourself 50 years into the future, can you really believe that we will still be building software the way we're building it now? And if we will be, then will it be all right? You know, will
I think neural nets, the AI neural net stuff, is the paradigm that is going to come in, be the new software production, which is even more sort of suck it and see than.
I just think the last one, I talk about medical design involved in the clinical side of the medical hospital systems, and it's unforeseen circumstances. This happened 2 weeks ago. A clerk at the hospital marked the one of the two twins as having died. Not uncommon in hospitals. That sends a message from the hospital system to my system. I then distribute that to the pharmacy system, the theatre system, the maternity system, the local GPs. We all marked the patient has died. It was realised at the hospital that the patient actually was on patient, so the hospital system allowed them to mark the patient has actually not died.
Okay.
I sent the message around to everybody else. Nobody else had thought they could bring patients back to life. So that ends up being an annual job with every single interconnected system. God help us.
Call it Lazarus, yeah.
Martyn, thank you very much indeed, not only for your talk, but for responding to the comments and questions. So we're delighted that you were able to do that. Thank you very much.
It's been a pleasure.
Our next meeting begins with the AGM, and it will be on Monday, the 17th of October. And the AGM will start at 2 o'clock and shouldn't take very long. And the presentation is scheduled to begin at 2:30. And the subject is Marian Wiedzinski's cyclometer. In the mid to late 1930s, Polish mathematicians created a number of methodologies to decrypt messages sent using three-rotary enigma. And the talk is going to discuss some of them and focus on the cyclometer, created by Marian Wiedzinski of the Polish Cipher Bureau's German section in the 1930s to facilitate decryption of the German Enigma cipher text. And it's a device for which our speaker, who will be Jerry McCarthy, is developing a working model using a mix of ancient and modern techniques. All events are advertised at our website, where there's a little sketch of the cyclometer and where you can pre-register very easily. So please do so, and I look forward to seeing you in October. Thank you.
Sorry about my instinctive neural nets.
I'll switch that one off. See how it works.